As a young man, I was always searching for God, always searching for something deeper. If anybody mentioned anything spiritual, I wanted to know more. I knew a little bit about God from Catholic school, and I had some babysitters who were Jehovah's Witnesses and were always talking about that, but neither ever quite satisfied my curiosity. My girlfriend at the time, her brother was a Buddhist. He always seemed pretty cool and calm, and so I thought I could learn something from him.
What was that?
This is the mystic law.
What's the poster about?
Well, people really don't know what it says because it's written in an ancient language.
So, right now, we're kneeling to a poster and we have no idea what it says.
This is the mystic law.
Yeah, that's all I needed to know about that. How could I kneel to a piece of paper when I didn't even know what it said or understood what it was? Needless to say, the search continued.
Why don't you have a seat? Right now is a good time to have a good conversation. You see, Dana's all right. She's just walking in her calling. And when you walk in your calling, you just gotta listen to what they're saying. You know that you have a calling too? I don't know if anybody ever told you this, or if you ever heard this, but you have a gift. The problem is, you and Dana are not fully developed yet. And because you're not fully developed, the spirits are clashing. Do you know how special you are? Do you want to help people?
The spirits, spirit guides, I don't get that, but yeah, I do. You know, I've been asking God to help me find my calling. And that is the only thing that I'm sure of so far. It's just that.
Papito, you're so powerful, and you don't even know it yet. We'll have to take you to the centro so you can begin your journey. Just trust us. You'll understand soon.
Bronx, New York, Prospect Avenue, little storefront on the street. Got there around 9 p.m., was told not to ask any questions and just take a seat. Soon after, candles were lit, the lights were turned down, Latin percussion was being played. The rhythms I would have enjoyed if only I wasn't so afraid. Dropped off, I didn't know I was gonna be left alone. Before me was an altar with a statue of every saint I've ever known. As the rhythms got louder, those in the front danced about, some setting their hands on fire while others started to shout. What have I stepped into? What did this all mean? All I knew in the moment, it was the darkest scene I've ever seen. Women smoking cigars, beads and handkerchiefs of all colors, everyone dressed in white. I grew up Catholic, I never seen church in this light. It's terrifying, God, how can this be right in your sight? But there it was, on the center of the table, by a glass filled with water, the Bible. Now after becoming fully prepared one by one that night, each chose someone from the crowd to get right. Someone who was the victim of witchcraft and with that spirit they'd fight. Devils casting out devils. Something wasn't right. Don't remember how many times they did that. Must have been 6 or 7. This started at 9 and it was now past 11. So many times that night I wanted to leave, but there was also something inside me that wanted so bad to believe. I didn't know if this was it or not. Was this my calling? Was this spiritual practice even viable? All I knew was that on that table, there was a Bible. And because I hadn't read it for myself, I had to believe what I was given. And by that fear, for the next year or so, I would be driven. Didn't know how I would get through this, but I told God I loved him enough to do this. If this is my price, I'll pay it. If this is what you want me to say, I'll say it. What you want me to pray, I'll pray it. That night, I was given a word, and I thought that sealed it. Those Friday nights at the Centro on Prospect Avenue would quickly become the regular routine. Even family members started coming out and taking part. As I became deeper involved, the fear and the torment increased, but the leader continued to speak into my life and assured me that I was doing the right thing for God. He told me he would show me in the Bible one day where it all was. One meeting, he even told me not to bother with the girl that was with me because she was not the one for me. She would later become my wife of now 35 years, but that comes later in the story. He told me that I would be one of those mediums at the table, the youngest one he's ever had there.
Junior.
Junior, come, sit down. You know why I decided to meet with you today?
No, I don't know why.
You don't know why? Junior, we've been watching you. We've seen you come to our meetings. We know you're looking for something.
Yeah, I am.
You see, there's great potential in you, Junior. God has called you for something. I feel like he's given you a special power and a purpose. It makes me wonder. Stand up, Junior. Come here. Closer. Junior, I want to work with you. And I want to develop you to become a medium just like me.
You think God has a calling and a purpose for me? You know, I want to serve God, and I do. I want to help people.
Yes, Junior, I understand. Come on. Seen the Bibles on our tables during our meetings? Oh, and we're doing God's work. Reminds me. I even just talked to your mother, too. And she decided, and we agreed, we're going to do your baptism here.
You spoke to Mom, and she said, yeah?
Yes, Junior. Welcome. Together we're going to do great things.
By this time, Michelle and I were a regular thing. I had already been groomed, baptized, and I was being trained in the religion. Started being used at the Centro on Friday nights, and I lived in constant torment and fear. I thought this work was the call of God on my life, and that fear was the price I'd have to pay to be in ministry. I prayed all the time, saying, I don't want this, but if this is what you want me to do, God, I'll do it. But if it's not, Lord, please rescue me and get me out of this.
I really wish that you didn't have to go right now.
Shao, please, you know I have to go to these meetings.
George, it makes no sense.
It's my obligation. I have to work the table. People are waiting to hear what I have to say. It's my calling from God.
These meetings and these people that are telling you that this is the only way and that this is the way to God, they don't know the truth. God is the only way. My grandmother says so all the time.
I know you mean well, but please, you do not understand. No, I have to go.
No, George, it makes no sense.
I know the truth. The truth is I'm helping others.
Listen, George, I know you're on a self-discovery journey, and I know you're trying to figure out what your purpose is, but God would not give you a calling that instills fear in you and terrifies you. You can't even sleep through the night unless your dad is awake.
I gotta go. I'm sure I'll be just fine. I'll get home. I'll be exhausted.
Babe, you can't sleep that night. You're calling out to your dad.
Yeah.
So, I have some really exciting news to share with you.
You do?
Yes. All right. Do you remember the commercial that I auditioned for?
Yeah, the Pepsi commercial, right?
Yes. Okay, so the director called me this morning and he told me that I landed the gig.
Get out!
Not only that, he wants me to join the Actors Union.
That's such an amazing thing! Oh my God, I know how much you love acting. And the Actors Union, it's so hard to get into.
You know, Shel, I'm really excited to see where, you know, this could all take me. But enough about me. How was your night?
My night was fine. I'm more concerned about you.
I really just don't want you to worry about me. I'm okay, though.
I still worry.
I know, but I'm okay.
Like, I wonder how the trailer looks.
You're already thinking of your trailer.
I'm already thinking about it.
You know, I'm excited for you, too. I know, like, this is your thing, like, acting and pursuing that kind of career.
Yeah.
It's like you're living your dream out.
It definitely is starting to feel like it.
But you know what I'm most excited about? I can't lie to you.
What's that?
You're finally going to get away from all of this Centro craziness.
So, why do you have to bring it up? We've been having such a nice day. You know, actually, I think it's time for me to get going soon.
Wait, where are you going?
It's Friday. You know where I go on Fridays.
No, George, you have to be kidding me. You're not going there again.
They need me.
Are you serious?
Yes, I work the table now. And if I'm where I'm needed, I'm going to go.
George, it makes no sense that you continue to put yourself in a situation that continues to instill fear in you. I don't understand this.
You know what's crazy? You don't have to understand it because it's not something you're doing. It's something that I'm doing.
Yeah, but it's not right.
I know.
It's not what God would want you to do.
Whatever
it's
you're
going
to tell
Hola,
me, I've heard
hijo,
it.
Hola, mis hijos, ¿qué haces?
Hi, bendición.
Hola, señoras.
Hi, abuela. Yeah, George was just dropping me off. We just had some lunch.
Why don't you both come inside with me for a minute? I need to speak to you both.
Thank you so much, but I'm really late for something and I have to go.
Come. It'll be quick.
Just come.
Okay.
So, where are you ladies coming from?
We're just coming back from a vigilia. We were all day praying and fasting.
All day?
All day.
Let me help you. Do you need some help in the kitchen? Let me put
this
up here for you. Willa.
And you know what, George?
What's that, Senora?
God answers prayers.
Yeah, I guess he does.
George, God loves you, and he has heard your prayers and has sent me today to speak to you. George, the Lord says, my son, I have heard your prayers, and I have seen your torment. I have sent my servant today to tell you that you are called and you are anointed. But this business that you're in is not of me. These are not my gifts. For I have heard you question, Lord, is this your will and plan for me to live in fear in order to serve you? My son, I tell you, I have not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. I have heard your cries and seen the nights that you've been up in fear of the enemy. My son, today is the day of salvation. I have called you and my daughter together in ministry. Draw yourself to me, and I will give you rest. I will give you peace, for I am Jesus and the Prince of Peace. I have a plan and a purpose for you both. Today, I say, today is the day of salvation and the day of rescue.
That night, I had the best sleep of my life. I was able to close my eyes for the first time in a long time and have no fear. God freed me and gave me peace. That day he showed me that he's real, that he hears my prayers. The Centro had told me that I had gifts that God wanted to use, but they were just using me. God said to me things that night that I've never told anyone. I left the Centro, even though I was warned you could never do that, and they never came looking for me, which I know was also a gift from God. I broke away from everything that tied me to the religion. A while later, Michelle and I stepped into a church and into a real relationship with Jesus, and we've never left. It hasn't always been a smooth ride, but God has proven himself to us time and time again that he is a God of his word. He's seen us through so many things, and we have never looked back. Wow. I think God is good. Amen. I love you, family. I love you, family. So good to be. To be with you. I think if we've achieved anything today, it has to be the strangest selection for an Easter service that we've ever done. When the ministry team approached me and asked to do it, I just wanted to be supportive and encouraging. Not fully realizing that that would mean that on the most visited Sunday of church life, the most expected Sunday of all year, we'd be putting on a presentation and they would not be any Roman guards or apostles or Mary or cross or an empty tomb. Just a story about some young kid, me, and how Jesus came, died, and rose again to set one person free.
And I just gotta believe that's what someone needed to hear today, that a story about a nobody who Jesus thought was somebody and laid down his body to set free everybody. We make Resurrection Sunday a big deal because without the empty tomb, this is just another dead religion. And we might as well all be dressed in one color doing stupid things. But there's an empty tomb, amen? And so listen, wherever you're at today regarding church, there's a couple of facts we need to deal with. The first one is Jesus came. There's plenty of proof that he existed, not just through the Bible or through religious texts, but from secular writers of that time. He existed. And his followers existed. And because they've written what they've seen and lived, and plenty has been written from them and about them, and so we also know that they existed. We know from historical text there was a crucifixion. That part is true. There was a cross. So the only thing left is the resurrection. And the Bible records that for 40 days after the resurrection, after the cross, Jesus appears to his followers many times and to different people at various times and locations before he ascended into heaven. So that means even after the cross, he stayed behind long enough to meet with those that loved him and followed him, to assure them, to comfort them, to make sure that they knew that the penalty for their sins had been paid for, that their debt had been covered, that he was the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, that was foretold in the scriptures thousands of years. See, death has been defeated. God is victorious, and so are all who trust in him. Those disciples lived and laid down their lives so that we would know and so that we would believe and so that we too could be set free. I don't know if you caught that or not, but the reason we named this illustrated message, "The Father is in the Room," was because when I shared my testimony with them, one of the things that stood out to them and one of the things that's always stood out to me was the fact that during that season of my life, in the midst of all the darkness, in the midst of all the spiritual battles, the uncertainty that came with all that, on many nights when I lay tormented and paralyzed in fear, there would come a point in time where I would just have to scream out for my dad. And you have to understand that a teen, I don't know how many of you teenagers at 17, 18 years old, screaming out for dad is not a good look. You know what I'm saying? But I was terrified. And so it was the only thing I could do to when the madness would not let my mind rest, when my bed would shake, when things would move, when I saw things that I shouldn't be seeing. It would come a point in time at the night where I'd have to scream out for my father. And you have to understand, it wasn't because my father would understand and he would come to the room and pray with me and lay hands on me. That, God bless him, but he wasn't that man, you know. He would actually scream at me and yell and tell me to shut up because he has to wake up early in the morning. But when I would hear my father's voice, it didn't matter to me how many curses he used. It didn't matter to me what he was saying. When I heard my father's voice, I was comforted. and the fear would diminish, and I could have peace, and I could fall asleep. I felt safe knowing that my father was in the room. That night, God answered my prayers by sending those Pentecostal ladies who would always have a special place in my heart. The ones with the long skirts and the buns and the big study Bibles. Saved my life. Saved my life. I was totally delivered from fear that night, from uncertainty, from torment. I was able to sleep in peace because he showed me that he had been there to hear me and to protect me and to cover me and to lead me. And he showed me that the reason I could be safe was that my heavenly father was always in the room. And not just for me, listen, family, Resurrection Sunday is about how the enemy believed the death of Jesus would be a victory, but it would be the very thing, in fact, that would set us all free. Free from death, free from uncertainty, free from the traps and the plans of the enemy, free from the dark things of this world, free even from the religion that binds us and confuses us and sets us down weird paths. And that's why something like this could make sense today. Because the empty tomb reminds us that the Father's in the room. And so our prayer today is that no matter what you're going through in this season in your life, I just pray this speaks to you. It's not enough to have a Bible on the table if it's not in you. It's not enough to just try and be a good person. Stop lying to yourselves. It's not enough to try to have your good outweigh your bad, and as long as there's a balance, you're doing all right. It's not enough to compare yourselves to the worst people in society and say, well, at least I'm not as bad as him or as her. It's not enough even to claim religion or to be religious or to be spiritual. The devil is spiritual. What I say to you today is if you've heard his voice, either through a word or a video or a song or a thought, we pray that you would find today peace, deliverance, and comfort, knowing that for you today, the Father's in the room. That he's here for you today. Whatever you're going through, whether you're alone or afraid or overwhelmed or overburdened, your heavenly Father is in the room. The prophet Isaiah said to Israel, the people of God, he said, don't panic. Hear this, somebody. This is a word for you. I'm with you, says the Lord. There's no need to fear, for I am your God. I'll give you strength. I'll help you. I'll hold you steady. I will keep a firm grip on you. Family, I can tell you, no matter how hard I ran, no matter the darkest places I went to search for God, he held me and kept me. I went into places that we didn't even talk about here. I believe they wrote this so mild because we didn't want to scare the bejesus out of everyone in the room. And so I didn't want the enemy to be glorified here. I didn't want nobody to be, amen? So understand, this was totally mild, but it was really real. And it was really dark. But God said he'd keep me. And no matter how far I ran, no matter how much I searched for him, some of us, let's be honest, we searched for God in some weird places. Amen? I'm really grateful that you're here today. And I just want to tell you, this is a safe place to search for him. You could come here and you don't have to believe. You don't have to be sure. You could just be around us. Come hang out with us. And just know that I know the Father's in the room. And so you'll start to feel the presence of the Father in the room. Amen? As believers, we can receive that prophetic word to Israel because we've been grafted into that family, the Bible says. We are his people. And he says to his followers in the Gospel of Matthew, right after the resurrection, he says, worship team, you guys can come up. He says, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So family, visitors, those of you that are just stepping in today, I want to give you a moment before. I won't apologize that we didn't have people dressed as apostles and everything that you might have expected, some sheep and some rocks and some empty tomb. But what we have is something real. And I can tell you it's real because I lived it. I tried it. I tried everything else. I tried to find God everywhere. I tried to find meaning to this life. And the only thing that brought me life was Jesus. The only thing that saved me, that delivered me. I can tell you, listen, there's a lot of people here that I've huddled with, prayed with, and broken this nonsense off of their lives. Because once God breaks chains, then you're a chain breaker. Amen. I had a family come to me and they said, how do we get rid of our altar? How do we get rid of all of this stuff? I said, here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to go to the back and I'm going to get these special bags. And I brought these specially anointed bags. It said Hefty on it, but it was, they're specially anointed. And I gave them two or three to take home. I said, these are special bags. I want you to take these home. And whatever you put in here, it's going to be smashed and delivered and you're going to be free from. Amen. And if I need to encourage you to do that, I encourage you to do that. And I know you might have been told you can't do that. You'll have this. They'll come after you. Listen, the Father is in the room. Amen. So just receive that today. I invite you to walk in that today as we just leave this place with some worship, with a song on your heart. Go ahead, my brother.